All right.
One thing that I'm trying this out this year, this meeting, to see if it works. And if you guys have a device, at the top you can see there's a little link. If you guys go to your, like, on your phone, if you guys go to that link, you guys can actually type in questions as we go. I'll get them. The nice thing is I can put them on the screen for us all to see them, but it also lets me add it to my things to add to the slideshow next time. It kind of like helps me take notes of what are questions that are coming up frequently at these meetings, because many times when I'm answering them, I'm not remembering what all those questions are. So feel free to use them. If you don't worry, if you just want to raise your hand, go old school, that's totally fine as well. I'll answer all of those.
Hello.
Hi.
We're going to talk about a lot of different stuff tonight. And I was telling somebody that I think that there's going to be a lot. I think this year will be a lot easier than the years prior for some people. Primarily because you guys, it's nice being here for more than 4 years and getting to see. This graduating class is my first full set of students, getting to go all the way through from having them from the babies in high school to graduate. So it's a nice thing to be able to walk through with students, because then too I can guide them a little bit more. I can see where they're thinking about. I know them throughout their entire high school career. So going into next year, you guys are going to be the year following that, but I know your students much better than I might have known your students 2 or 3 years ago. Okay, so that's really helpful when we're talking about college stuff. As you guys are coming in, and if you guys didn't grab anything, don't feel obligated again to grab everything up here. If it runs out, I just didn't print it. All of this is available electronically, and I'll show you in just a minute where you can access that. One more kind of housekeeping heads up. Our website is changing. Okay, so in case it hasn't yet, it was supposed to today. Our website will be transitioning to a new website. All the content will still be there, but it will look different. All right, I'm going to highlight where you can find information that's on the counseling area, but you might have, just fair warning, you might have to poke around a little bit to find a few new places. Just remember when Google Drive changed and everyone freaked out, like, you know, this is the same thing. But all the stuff is still there. If you guys get lost, I'm happy to help. I like doing that kind of stuff. So today we're going to talk about all the stuff that you really need to know going into your senior year. All right, I went to Junior Pathways, one of the classes. I don't think I made it to sixth period because I had meetings, but, history classes. And I talked to them about what we're going to talk about tonight. It's an hour. Maybe an hour and a half, depending on how many questions you guys have, of stuff that you guys really need to start pre-thinking about going into the fall of next year. Because just think about how fast high school is already gone for your students that are going to be seniors next year. High school, or your senior year, is going to go by 4 times that fast. All right, and really, when we get back in the fall, we have to hit the ground running. Okay. It is not something that we can wait until November to get our wheels going and get our momentum going and be pushing and parents pushing and people kind of being resistant as seniors, especially with that 4-year college application, but anything, okay? Because we don't have any hoops times. We don't have any makeup time as a senior. A couple things that we're going to talk about tonight. Let's see if this is going to work for me. We're going to look at the broad spectrum. All right, there's a lot of different people in this room and a lot of people that are also watching on YouTube, but we're going to look in general. I know that there will probably be quite a few personalized individual questions, and those are wonderful here, but I might just ask you, just for sake of time and possibly privacy, to maybe set up a meeting with me later that we can discuss some of those maybe personalized questions a little bit later, because it might be very specific to your individual child. But we will talk generally about the college application timeline, also financial aid, also things like important things to watch out for in your senior year, because we have this cycle of events that happens, and it's very cyclical in your senior year, except you guys aren't hopefully going to do it all over again, just one time, one cycle. Talk about a couple of the different application systems that are out there. There are a lot, and we'll go over the main ones. And we'll warn you about one of them as well that you might have heard about. Talk about some of the loose ends that I see frequently that happen to students in all various ranges. Okay, our 4.2s to our 1.0s. Many, you know, there's something that starts with an S that's called senioritis. Okay, it hits all levels and all performance ranges. Okay, and it is a very, very, very dangerous thing. Not like physically dangerous. dangerous usually. But it is very dangerous regarding post-high school plans. Because people think, hey, I got my acceptance to Boston College, I'm rocking and rolling, and they're like, I don't have to really pay attention to calc anymore, I have to pay attention to English, and all of a sudden, we are now having to make phone calls to the admissions department, and things like that. So I'm just giving you guys a heads up. We're recording right behind you.
Oh, sweet.
So I don't know if people can see through that. But they're also recording your voices. So the last thing is, parents especially, don't freak out. Okay? It's a very exciting but very fast-paced time of the year that people make it. We just had 74 graduates on Thursday who had a wonderful time at graduation. We're all off to things. Some of them kicking and streaming as we pull them along, and others of them ready to rock and roll and get out of here. Okay, but it is very fun. But I can almost promise you, students too, there will likely be some sort of tears shed in the next year, maybe multiple times. Okay, for a lot of different reasons: a lot of happy tears, a lot of sad tears, a lot of mad tears, a lot of frustrating tears. Okay, and I warned you guys when you guys are in my office, like, I'm trying to tell you this so that we don't have the crying moments multiple times in senior year in my office. I like you guys, but I prefer you guys smiling over crying, if possible. And then we'll have some time for questions, again, hopefully general questions, since there's so many of us. The big thing that I want to start with is be ready to be inundated with information from me, from your teachers, from the individual colleges, from Bob Jamison, our career tech, from our grad night coordinator, from everybody under the sun. They're going to be pumping your kids for information, and we're going to be trying to pump you full of information. Because we've tried, I think we've done it over the years, so hopefully all this stuff isn't brand new information. But a lot of it changes, and a lot of it is not necessarily something that you're going to remember from last year. Okay, so be ready. Take good notes, and don't feel dumb to ask questions. Okay, that's what I'm here for. That's what your teachers are here for. That's what Ms. Mitchell is here for. If you guys don't know about something, I'd much rather you guys ask it than not ask because you're embarrassed or you think you should know it, but you don't. And we get to the admissions time and something fell through the cracks because there was a miscommunication. So please ask and we'll make sure that you understand it. Like I said, everything that is on this table is available online. A couple things that I wanted to point out. There's a PDF, and this one's a big one. It's about 60 pages long, so I didn't print 40 of them. But this is my college handbook. Okay, so I took some information, I added some information, and compiled a bunch of things you might need to know next year. So that you can print it out, you can highlight it, you can draw on it, you can read all the important terms, you can see all the NCAA information, all in one packet. All right, this is available online. So please take some time this summer. Juniors, this is an important document if you're going to be applying to a four-year college. Maybe not in one sitting, and maybe at the beach, but read this, okay? It will be very helpful in demystifying the process next year, all right? It's just a good thing to come in with some information and knowledge about.
So we look it up online?
Yeah, I will show you.
Okay.
I have a picture of where you can find it.
Okay.
One slide. The second thing, especially seniors, but also parents, I know when Dr. Leary calls me, I shouldn't say this on YouTube. When Dr. Leary calls me, oh, it's the district, okay, it'll go to voicemail. And I get an email or check the voicemail later and things like that. Please don't do that your senior year. Okay, please pick up every phone call. It's especially important because things like deadlines, and these deadlines really do matter in senior year. All right, we're going to have things like, hey, there's, remember the UCNCSU application is due on November 30th. Did you guys submit? If you guys don't get that voicemail until December 3rd, you're out of luck. Okay, so please, when you see the phone call, hey, turn in this. Be here for that. Make sure that you're answering this survey because we need all this information to move forward with your senior year. Please double check those. Students especially, read your emails. Set up a system, whether it's for 40 minutes, twice a week, that you go through and just delete everything you don't need to read and read everything that you do. Okay, but because I've seen many of your inboxes. Okay. And they're ugly. It's like 20,000 unread emails. My nightmare. Okay, but it's also good practice, because in college, your professors are not going to call you. They're not going to go grab you out of class. They're going to shoot you an email. If you read the email, great. If you don't, you're out of luck. Okay, so it's good practice for that. It's also good practice for work. So just build that skill now, and it will save you time and energy later. All right, so here's this. This is what our new website part of it will look like. Okay, again, if it's still on the old website, it's supposed to be changing today, but might take a couple days, I guess. Underneath programs will now be where the counseling page area is. There's not going to be a main counseling link like there is on our current website. And so if you click on there, it's going to take you. This is my area that I'm updating. A lot of the information will transition over there. This is how you make an appointment, get on Naviance. And then the college and career counseling area, I'm trying to break it down and redoing a little bit to make it a little bit clearer. And then counseling resources. That counseling resources is where you can find a lot of these PDFs that you can download. You can print them if you want. If you want to like write on them, highlight them, and that kind of thing. But that's going to be where it is. Again, this is our main page when you go to the website once it changes over. When you hover over programs, this whole link will show up. And then if you go to counseling, it'll take you here. And this area will become your new best friend for next year, with information and resources. And I'm still in the process of transferring a few things over. Any questions about that? Everything that you see up here will be on there, plus more. I have they're called grade level resource folders. It's basically a bunch of shared Google Drives that I have tons of information, articles I found online, helpful links, other pieces of information, the NACAC, which is the National Association of College Admissions Counseling, the national association for those people that work in admissions, which I am a part of, they have a handbook that's in there. So tons and tons of information, but not just that, careers, two-year colleges, how do I deal with kids that are not doing what I want them to do, all kinds of information that you might need to know. Okay, so we're gonna talk a little about timeline, and this is general. Okay, again, there's going to be, if I say this is how it is, there's going to be one or two schools or one or two possibilities that this is not how it will work. But in general, this is your general timeline for going through the beginning of your senior year to the end of the senior year, thinking about college in particular. So in the very beginning of the year, throughout the summer and starting through August, you're going to need to get all of your ducks in a row. Okay. Hopefully last year you kind of listened to my poking and prodding, students especially, and started to put together a list of schools. Started to think about, hey, these are interesting schools that I want to look into a little bit more, that I've started doing a little research on. I've written down a few things. If not, now is the time to do that. You still have time. It's not too late. But now it's starting to be, hey, we need to start populating that list. Okay? And I'll tell you what I mean by list in just a second. But you need to start populating that list of schools. Most people, for four-year colleges in particular, you're going to be applying anywhere between 5 to 10, usually about 7-ish, different schools. Okay, do not apply to just one four-year college. That is not a good plan. Okay. However, on the flip side, if you are looking at, say, a junior college or a trade school, many times those schools, they're not what we would call competitive admissions environments. Okay, they are what are called open enrollment schools. As long as you meet certain criteria, which you know is typically like a high school diploma, you can enroll in, say, Sierra College or Lake Tahoe Community College in Southlake. And they don't limit you by your GPA or that you didn't meet your A through G requirements. You can enroll there. The problem is that's facing a lot of the community colleges in California especially is because they're open enrollment, there's so many kids there, many times the classes fill up. Okay, so that's a big challenge. It sometimes hinders that two-year transfer pathway to a four-year college. Sometimes it becomes a 3 or even 4-year transfer pathway because of that problem. So doing your research and talking and making sure that your timelines are aligned with that school will be an important process for the two-year route. Depending on what type of application you're going to be submitting for a four-year college, kind of jumping back into that boat, is going to depend on when you need to start and when you need to finish that application. Okay, we'll go over the different types of application. I have a different slide for that piece that kind of explains, because there are several different formats that students apply to college in. However, most schools are going to start accepting those sometime in the beginning of usually October and go anywhere through March to the end of the year even. the majority of schools will probably close their applications right around the end of January in general. Okay? Our state institutions, the CSUs, the California State Institutions, and the UCs, the University of California schools, are all due on November 30th at midnight, well, 11:59. That might even be Eastern. I know that they've had that happen before, where people thought they were in on time, but it was actually late because their servers were on the East Coast and they're on a different time. So just keep that in mind. Early is your best friend. That time frame is also a great time to start looking at scholarships. I know one of the big questions I always get is, when are scholarships available? When are scholarships available? Because part of going to apply to college is, how the heck am I going to pay for this? Financial aid and applications are two different processes. Okay, we'll talk mostly about the application process tonight. We'll dabble a little bit in the financial aid. The financial aid process I'm going to save until the fall, primarily because there's a lot of changes that we don't have tons of information about yet. But we will talk about that at a different event because it deserves a night of its own. But we will talk a little bit about it. The FAFSA, which is the free application, and free is a key word, the free application for federal student aid, that is the government's application for financial aid. Okay, that's the thing that's going to take all your IRS information that the schools are going to get, and they're going to determine how much you're going to owe based on your income. All right. There's also another application that's accepted and required by about 150 typically highly selective schools. That's called the CSS profile. That's a different application. It actually costs money, so don't be surprised there. Not a lot. It's like 25 or 30 bucks or something. I forget off the top of my head. But it does cost some money, and you'll have to fill that out for those 150 different schools or so. The difference is going to be this. Okay, I kind of liken it to buying a house or selling a house. Your FAFSA is going to be, the realtor is going to be coming around, kind of looking around your house, checking through your bathrooms. Hey, okay, it's got a sink, it's got, you know, a refrigerator, it's got carpeting and things like that. Okay, they're just kind of like giving it a cursory look. The CSS profile is the home inspector. They're going to come out and they're going to look under the carpet, they're going to dig underneath the house, they're going to check your foundation, they're going to check everything. Primarily because those schools are going to be very expensive that typically require that CSS profile. They usually are the more pricey institutions. We're talking $40,000 to $60,000 a year pricey. The good news, if there is good news about having your financial home inspected, is for almost most people, a lot of people, that CSS profile actually helps you get more money in many circumstances. Because that school is going to cost you $60,000, they can't necessarily just look at your income. They have to look at your assets. They have to look at your rental income, but also your expenses. If you have a business, they're going to look at your business expenses and things like that. So often, it actually opens up opportunities for more financial aid. So don't be afraid of that if you guys are going through that. Many times you don't have a whole lot of choice. The last thing I'll talk about financial aid before we move on for a little bit is, please keep in mind, I am not a financial advisor. This is my kind of warning to you, cautionary tale. I do not give financial aid advice. I don't give financial advice to people. I'm happy to help you guys fill out information. I'm happy to help you research and complete the right information on the forms. However, I cannot advise you, legally or ethically, to put your money over here, to change your investment to this, to help you lower your costs. If you guys are in a more challenging financial circumstance, and up here it's especially difficult because of how many people's incomes fluctuate year to year, with the seasons and with how the tourism market is and that kind of stuff, I'd highly suggest, and it usually is worth it, to hire a financial planner for that circumstance, especially going into college. They can help you make sure that you're going legally, that you are following all the rules that's set forth by the IRS, and making sure you're not doing anything illegal with your money based on financial aid. For most people that are on generally set incomes, it's a relatively simple process, especially with the FAFSA. CSS profile, when you own your own business, if there's annuities, a lot of like really interesting type of income, that's where it really gets tricky and you might want to pay that little bit of money. And usually what I've seen is it actually saves you money in the long run because it actually, you can move things around correctly. All right. Am I going too fast? I know I'm talking a lot. Any questions so far that I haven't gotten to yet? December through June, is going to be your time frame typically when the majority of those scholarships come out. Okay, it usually comes out after the new year rolls over. And the majority of money that people actually get comes from two places: your school and the local community. Okay, you're not. I have never seen $1 million check come through my office. I don't know any other counselor that's had $1 million check come through their office from McDonald's or Dr. Pepper or kick that field goal and, you know, win a free college education. That's not where money usually comes from, so I would not suggest actually spending a whole lot of time and giving up that much privacy. Essentially, you're signing yourself up for a mailing list, and it's a sweepstakes. If you want to do that, that's your call. Just expect a lot of robocalls and a lot of junk mail and things like that. But the typical places are going to be your merit scholarships, your need-based scholarships from the schools, and then also our local community. The local community gave about almost $80,000 this year to this school, and it fluctuates anywhere between $80,000 to $150,000, depending on where the money goes between the two comprehensive high schools here. The majority, our senior class earned, I won't say got or was awarded, but earned, $1.7 million this year. Okay, that's a lot of money for about 50 students that are planning on going on to college out of 74 graduates. Okay, so that's a lot of money for 50 kids. However, like I said, about 80,000 of that came from our local community. The rest came from the institutions themselves. Okay, so again, shows you how much money that those colleges are going to be giving you. But typically, it's going to be that merit-based scholarship. Two types of money that comes from financial aid or CSS profile: merit, meaning you earn this by doing something, whether that's athletics, music, academics, community service, some club that you joined or started awarded you a scholarship. And then there's need-based. Okay, need-based, you don't do anything to earn. The only thing that is considered with the need-based is your income, usually. So that's going to be usually given by the school because they say, hey, you know, it's $60,000. You guys make $40,000 a year. You're going to need some money to make that work. And the institution will award need-based grants. But then the federal government also awards need-based aid. And it comes in scholarships, grants, which is free. Those two are free money. And it comes in loans, okay, the L word. And a lot of people are scared of loans. I'm not going to harp on loans for right now. I'll save that for next year. But just know, it's an investment, and loans typically are what make that possible as long as you are smart about it. Okay, that's the big thing. Be smart about taking out loans when you need to. Finally, all the way at the end of the process comes May 1st or some other date if May 1st is on a weekend. Typically, if it's on a weekend, it goes the day, Monday following May 1st. That's going to be typically what most schools consider National Decision Day. Okay, that's when most four-year colleges are going to expect typically now an electronic check mark that I'm intending to enroll in the fall, plus a deposit of some amount. Okay, and usually housing goes along with that as well. After that, your admissions decision might be up in the air. Okay, so you know typically you're gonna want to make that call by that time, and hopefully you have plenty of different decisions to choose from. Okay, so that's the idea. That is next year. College admissions-wise, financial aid-wise, a year at a glance. A lot more stuff in there, but that's just the overview. Okay. We have a very interesting process in the United States when it comes to financial aid and applications and college in general, in that I call it reverse shopping. All right. What I mean by that is we're telling you all throughout high school, and you guys are hopefully starting to think about, okay, where am I going to college? Where do I want to go? And you go out and you research and you pick it out, just like you're going to car shopping. You know, you're going on Edmunds and you're going on, you know, Kelley Blue Book and seeing, okay, what cars are the best? Consumer Reports says this is the best car out there. Great, let's go test drive it. Let's go walk around it. Make sure that it feels good to us. And then you go and pick out your favorite car. And then you go to the place where you check out and you have to sign on the dotted line. And they say, oh yeah, it's going to cost you $200,000. And you say, what? We actually do the application process a lot different than many other countries, where we actually, you pick which schools you want to go to and apply before you actually know how much it's going to cost you. And it's kind of a silly way to do it, but that's just the way it works. So just know that, is you guys won't know necessarily how much school is going to cost you each year, mind you, when you're submitting those applications. However, there are a number of tools that you guys can use to help determine that process. The federal government has any institution receiving public funds, which is almost all of them. And you know, even the private schools, many times they receive public funding for something. They are required to have on their website a what's called a cost of attendance calculator or a net price calculator. Usually under financial aid, sometimes under the admissions area of the website. Junior colleges as well will have this net price calculator, where it will ask you very generally, what is your income? And it'll say, based on your income, here is what we think a standard award package may look like next year. Always take with a grain of salt. The federal government last year pushed it. The federal Pell Grant is a big funder for educational grants, and they pushed how much they are actually going to fund right down to the wire. They actually funded it, but it's still up in the air whether they're going to continue that next year. So just know all this stuff is contingent on things falling through, but it gives you a good idea. Right, so I would highly suggest when you're looking at colleges, when you're building this list that we're about to talk about, get on the website. Number one place to get information about their school. Okay, I know a lot, but there are 6,000 universities in America, okay, and I do not know much about any, you know, all of them. I know a lot about a few of them. I know some about some, and a little about a few. But there's some that I've never even heard of in America. So, when we come back in the fall, here's what we need to have ready to go. So seniors, you are seniors pretty much now. You guys can be called seniors at this point. So seniors, when you guys return in the fall, here's what we're going to be having to do. We're going to need a list, okay? Especially if you guys are looking at four-year college. How many people, just so I know, are going to be planning on applying to a four-year college next year? Whether or not you want to go to one or not. If you're going to apply to a four-year school, we need this right away. If you're going to apply to a junior college, it's still good to have a list. You still want to have a list. It might be smaller than this, but you're still going to need to pick and choose, because while you might not have to compete with other students to get in, you still want to go to a place that has the offerings that you want, that is in a location that you want, does it have dorms? Does it have a auto shop? Does it have anything that I'm looking for? So you might want to pick one or two that so you can start researching those tools. However, this model here, this kind of 7 to 10, 5 to 10 model, is typically for the students going to like a four-year college or university after high school immediately. The reason why we suggest 5 to 10, it's a pretty standard number. I see students, we had a student this year that applied to about 25 different schools, and they spent a bunch of money and a bunch of time. And it got into quite a few, but it also creates problems at the end where you have 20 decisions to make up your mind from sometimes, and a lot of different options. And sometimes when you're making a big life decision like that, you don't want 20 different options. You want like 3 or 4 options, okay? So keep that in mind too for the amount of schools you apply to. But you don't want just one or two, because every school that you apply to at the four-year level is competitive. No, nothing is guaranteed. They could say, we have 100% acceptance rate. Hogwash. There's someone that didn't get in, okay, for some reason. So view every application, no matter how easy or hard you think the college might be. And that has, by the way, no determination on how quality that school is. Just because the school has 5% acceptance rate does not mean that it's better than a school with 80% acceptance rate. It has no correlation. There's never, ever been a scientific correlation. There's never, ever been any type of thing other than the U.S. News Report, whose job is not to rate schools. Their job is to sell books and advertising. Okay, so always read those things with a grain of salt and just know that everything is competitive. If you guys apply to one or two, you are stacking statistics against you. And statistics are not usually nice to people. Okay, they're usually pretty mean and rough. And we tend to fall on the wrong side of the statistics pretty often. Okay, even with 80%, it feels pretty safe, feel pretty confident, and we have students that get into a school with 20% and get denied from a school with 80%. there's a lot of gray area there. So this model gives you a spread admissions-wise and gives you a spread hopefully financially as well. So my model and the general model that most college counselors and advisors follow are is you want one or two REACH schools. So by REACH, I don't mean just hard for the heart's sake. Schools that maybe you have your heart set on that is either hard for everybody. We're talking Harvard's, MIT, Stanford's. Those are, doesn't matter if you are cured cancer, they can still deny you and be hard to get in there. Okay? Or hard for you as a person. Okay, so that might mean San Diego State. San Diego State is a competitive school, not nearly as competitive as, say, Harvard. But, you know, if you're shooting, if you're at a 3.8, 3.5, that might be a REACH school for you. Okay? Where it might be a little bit more of a good fit school for someone, say, 3.9, 4.0 maybe, in a weighted GPA. A couple good fits when you're looking at college information. Naviance is a wonderful tool. You go to the search for individual college, say Cal Poly, it'll give you all of this data. It will update typically over the summer with this last year's applicant data, but you can get on there now and see kind of average SAT scores. You can see average GPA. You can see average ACT scores. Typically in other areas, you can find things like average financial aid awarded. You can find, there's websites out there called like MITSI, which is one of them. There's a cost associated with that, but it is fairly interesting because they'll actually have people who did apply and get in, come back on here and share their entire application about here's what I did, here's how I did this. So you can get some examples of admitted essays. You can get some examples of what kind of community service this person did. Just take it, again, with a grain of salt, but it's good for examples base. And then one or two safe schools, and that's what that asterisk is for. There's no such thing as a truly safe school. But that's going to be a school where you kind of are above and beyond their average requirements. So you might have a 3.8 and their average is a 3.3. I would say in that area, you'd probably be a pretty safe admit. However, on the opposite spectrum, if this average is 3.8 and you have a 3.3, that's probably going to be more of a REACH school for you because you're on the opposite end of that spectrum. So looking at those kind of averages is very important. Again, enough schools. Make sure that you're filling those things out. In the fall of next year, I should have brought those up here. I did not. Before you guys leave, if you guys want, many of these colleges, especially a lot of private schools, are going to request something called letters of recommendation. Okay, we're kind of jump ahead, but it kind of links with what's up here. Letters of recommendation are required for a lot of schools to get in, as well as scholarships. However, no teacher, including myself here, is going to write you one without something called a senior profile. Okay? Senior profile is essentially our cheat sheet to know what you've done. Okay? Because we know you in the classroom, we know you're around the school, but we didn't know that you won this national championship of this, that, and the other thing, that you built this thing from scratch that's really cool, that you've been involved in ballet for 16 years since you could walk, stuff like that. We don't necessarily know that about you. Okay, so the senior profile is essentially a little brag sheet that you can fill out that will help us complete letters of recommendation more completely and more holistically. We're going to talk mostly about what we know about you from here, but we want to make sure it's accurate as well. So I would suggest that's another great summer activity, and I'll make sure that I print out a bunch and put them in the front office by the phone where all of those community service forms go to. A big stack of these things that you guys can start filling out. Sometimes people are saying, well, I have a resume. Great, attach it. But a lot of it, you know, if it's already on your resume, you don't need to fill it out twice, but it's a great use of your summer time because when you come back, you'll have it done. You don't have to worry about it at the beginning of the year because when your teacher's asking, you want to have it ready. You don't have to fill out like 20 of them. You just make one, come to the office, make copies. Okay, that's what the copy machine's for. All right. While I'm pretty good at my job, I'm usually in this point and sense as a senior when you're going through specific applications, unless I've experienced that specific problem that you might and probably will come up with as you're going through the application process, whether it's at any level, four-year, two-year, trade school, the number one place and number one resource for those questions is going to be that individual school itself. Okay? Most likely, if I can't find it on their website, I'm going to pick up the phone and call them. And there, it's not a special counselor line that I pick up and like, hey, you know, say the secret word and I get all the right information. Okay, sometimes I'm better at it because I do it more frequently. So I know the right people to talk to, I know the right questions to ask. However, those people are 100% available to you guys too. All right? So anytime there's a question, I might say, you know, I don't have an answer for that and I couldn't find it online. Typically, I suggest the family, and especially I suggest the student, pick up the phone and call the school itself if you guys want the true from the horse's mouth answer about something that might affect your admissions, about financial aid. And I don't say that, I don't want it to come off as sounding rude or that, you know, I don't want to help you. I just want to make sure that you guys get the accurate information. And, you know, while I could make the phone calls for you, every admissions officer that I talk to, and I talk to quite a few each year, they tell me, we want to hear from the student. This, your senior, next year, many of them might already be adults. If not, they're going to be adults in the next 8 months to a year. Okay, and in a year from now, they'll be trudging off, getting ready to trudge off this college, okay, where you aren't going to be able to make phone calls for them, parents, where you aren't going to be able to get the questions answered for them. And sometimes that's scary for parents. It's sometimes, you know, I feel scary when I have to send my dog to the vet, and that's not even a comparison, because I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's going on. You know, I feel like I do the WebMD research and scare myself to death, and I don't know how to address an issue with my dog. And your kids are so much more important than my dog. And college is a much more large problem and, like, hoops to jump through than going to a vet. Okay, so I totally get, like, where I don't totally get, but I can empathize with the things that you guys are going to be going through in the next year because I've helped many parents do it before. So don't feel like you're not doing your job because you don't know an answer. I don't know a lot of the answers either. I do this a lot. Okay, so the big thing is knowing where we can turn and asking the right questions. another wonderful summer activity. And this does require a little bit of availability and typically a little bit of money to be put towards it. If you haven't done it yet, and you have that list of schools, try to narrow it down to your top few and do everything you can to visit those schools. Okay? Visiting schools is my favorite way, and hearing almost across the board from students who do visit schools that is the number one thing that determines where or where not they are going. Okay? I've had literally students, their number one and number two choice on their college list going into their senior year. They visited over the summer. That school was not even on their list when fall came. Okay, and a school that was not even on their list, they happened to go by that campus, and that became their favorite school, and they ended up going there. Okay, so that is how powerful a school visit is. Because think about it. When I'm on McDonald's website, are they going to post those crappy pictures of those little flat hamburgers? No. They're going to post the really pretty, photoshopped, you know, airbrushed burgers. Same thing with colleges. They're not going to turn around and take a picture of the shanty town across town from campus. They're going to take a picture of the beautiful performing arts center, all lit and beautifully decorated. Okay? And so you don't get to see the entire picture of the campus. And many times if you go, you know, we hear back from students who leave school. And when I get sad when a student doesn't like the school that they end up going to and they want to change or they come back and things like that. It bums me out because I feel like sometimes I didn't do my job correctly. Many times what happens is those are the same students that never visited a campus. Many times they were the student that maybe didn't do their research fully. Sometimes that's not the case. Sometimes they visited, and sometimes it just doesn't work out. It didn't work out for me. I visited Cal Poly. I enrolled in Cal Poly. Cal Poly was not for me. I did not like the program. I did not like how it worked for my learning style. So I changed to a different program, completely different major, and finished and loved it. And went on to grad school and finished that too and loved it. So it's not always about that. But doing that visit and doing that research ahead of time will save that headache and heartache that happens if that does become the circumstance. So please visit. Almost every college, even community colleges, trade schools, you know, universal technic- Institute, places like that, most of those schools are going to have what's called outreach or public relations or the admissions office. One of those three different areas is typically going to have school tours being offered. Sometimes you can call a request and they'll have we have people available. Kind of depends on the size of the school. Other times they have set times that, we give tours at 2:00 every day with a student who will walk you around in a group. You probably will have to look that up on the website for each individual school, but please do that. And if you have an opportunity to take a tour, it's much more powerful than just walking around campus. But if you can't, walk around campus by yourself. Jiggle the door handle, see if you can get in. Knock on the admissions office doors and see if they have answers for you, if they have a cool sweatshirt that you can, score or something like that. All those things are very important. But then the other side of that coin is leave campus. Okay? Because, yes, you will probably spend about 80% of your time on that campus while you're in college. However, many times people don't live on campus all 4 years or 6 years or however long it's going to take you to get through college. Okay? They're going to have to live and typically work in that community as well and enjoy that community. Okay? So don't just look at the campus, because you're going to have to jump off that campus at some point. And if you hate the town, you hate the location where it's at, it makes that campus a little bit harder to be at. Okay, that fit doesn't quite work well for you. So don't do that. Just go downtown too. Go out to eat. Talk to people around town. Say, what do you like about this area? What don't you like? Try to get a wide range of opinions, but it's pretty. You get a feel when you come up here. People feel generally nice. When you go to LA, sometimes they're not so nice. Okay, so you have to, especially for our kids who have maybe not lived in that circumstance. It's going to be sometimes a very rude awakening. Even beautiful places like San Diego, being huge. It's a wonderful place. I love San Diego myself, but it can be a very big culture shock for students. Instead of just visiting the area that the town is in, asking the university people, hey, where do most people live off campus? Go visit that area. See if it's nice. See if there's gang members walking around. Very kind of silly, but very seriously do that. Start looking at essays now. All right. If you have an idea, say, hey, we're going to go over the different college application systems. If I'm going to apply, I'm 95% sure I'm applying to at least one of the UCs. Great. There's a number of application essays that you have to write that will take some time. All right. If you're going to apply, I'm pretty sure I'm going to apply to a school that's on the Common App. Great. There's a number of essays that you're going to have to write for that Common Application that are general to the entire system. There's a number of supplemental essays for each individual school and some of those different programs, but they're general application essays and personal statements that you are going to have to write a response to. That is a wonderful thing to start pondering. You don't need to start and finish over the summertime, but start brainstorming. Write things down that are important to you, that are important to answering those questions, and those questions are all available online. Google, Common Application Essays. There you go. Google, and it's actually, what do we call it now? It's not the personal statement, and it's the personal insight questions. The UC system, if you've had an older child go through the UC application, it is a different set of questions now. Just a heads up. Okay, so, and they're better changes, good changes. Shorter questions, more open-ended. But you have to answer a different number of them. Because when you come back, you're going to want someone to look at those essays. I'm happy to look at those essays. Your English teachers are going to be happy to look at those essays, but we cannot look at 50 essays all at one time. Okay, so we have, if the earlier you get those in, the more likely we are to be able to look at those before any type of major deadline hits. All right, and please don't do this, students. Yo, what's up? Can you read my essay? Okay, so we're going to start having to teach you guys about professional interactions. Because if you do that to your college professor or your boss, they're going to turn around and say, I don't know who that person is. I'm just going to ignore you. I'm just going to be mean to you, things like that. So please practice approaching your teachers, approaching myself. If you approach me incorrectly, I'm going to try to nicely but firmly say, I'm sorry, that's not how you request a letter of recommendation. Can you please try again tomorrow? And I'm going to say no. And we're going to talk tomorrow or the next day until you get it right. Okay? Because your teachers are well-educated professionals who... sometimes you don't always respect them. I get it. In this circumstance, they're going to be spending a good hour to 2 hours plus writing you a very personal letter that typically is one of the things that makes or breaks your application. Okay, so please do your very best to be respectful when requesting those letters. Same thing if you're applying to financial aid. Many times those trade schools, two-year schools, aren't going to be quite as intense as this four-year application process. However, for things like financial aid, you typically need to ask for a letter of recommendation. All the community scholarships, you need to ask for a letter of recommendation. So practicing that, getting that skill ready is very important. All right, keep on moving. Junior college. So very important, even if you're looking at four-year colleges, junior college is a wonderful opportunity for every student. Okay. It might not be the best match, but it's definitely a viable option for anybody. Students can get anywhere. Okay, we just had a student who graduated my second year attend a school in Southern California, a junior college in Southern California, just get a giant scholarship and accepted to UCLA as a transfer student. So that's very cool. Students can go anywhere. The nice thing about junior colleges is, like I said, they're not a competitive admissions environment, so you're not competing against hundreds of thousands of other students for a spot. Another thing is typically, and I say typically because it very much is dependent on your situation, sometimes they can be cheaper. Sometimes they can actually be more expensive. So you have to really look at that. Okay, when you do your FAFSA, and we're not going to get into the EFC, but you're going to get a number back after you complete it. It says EFC, Expected Family Contribution. If your EFC is zero, it's going to be zero at Harvard, it's going to be zero at Cal Poly, it's going to be zero at Sierra College. Okay. So the colleges might not be able to meet that need. That's where kind of the decision-making process comes in. But Harvard might be able to say, hey, we're going to give you, $55,000 out of $60,000 a year it's going to cost, whereas Sierra College might say, we're not giving you anything, and it's going to cost you $10,000 to come here, including room and board. And they'll say, okay, well, cheaper to go to Harvard. So some circumstances, don't think, the blanket statement of community college is cheaper always applies. Let me see if I said that right. That four-year college is more expensive than community college. It does not always fit. Often that's the case, but it's not always. Okay, so just remember that. Financial aid deadlines still apply. You still can earn financial aid, both merit and need-based financial aid at community colleges. Okay, so still complete the FAFSA. Okay, I think that every single person on the planet Earth who's a senior should fill out the FAFSA. There's no reason not to. Okay? It's free. It's nothing new for the government. They already have all that information. They don't need it. They just need you to put it all in one place. Say, I want help. I want the possibility of earning this money that I might need or get. Schools often will use that to provide merit scholarships as well as our local scholarships. Okay, so if you don't fill out the FAFSA, you don't have an EFC, that means they can't consider that factor into deciding whether you need or should get merit aid. It also can provide opportunities for things like low-cost loans. Okay? Circumstances change, especially up here. People lose jobs, financial situations in one year might be different than next year, and if you don't fill out the FAFSA, you're basically signing away your right to have the school be able to give you any type of help or support. And then it's going to be up to Bank of America. It's going to be up to Chase or some other big bank who's going to charge you four times the interest rate on that same amount of money. Okay, whereas the government guarantees a certain interest rate each year. Okay, so I would highly encourage you, I don't care if you make $20 million, fill out the FAFSA. The worst it's going to tell you is, sorry, you don't earn it. You can't give you anything. But if you do that, you might have that availability to get that later. Okay, so one of my goals for this year, just so you guys know, is my goal is I want at least 80%. I would love 100% of all of our families to fill out the FAFSA. I don't care if you have a 0.0 GPA. I want it filled out. I don't care if you're not a citizen. I want the DREAM Act filled out. I don't care if you make $100 million and have a private jet. I want you to fill out the FAFSA. So I'm going to bug you guys about the FAFSA. So please fill that out. Please factor in the room and board costs at junior college as well. Same thing with four-year colleges. When you're looking at a cost of attendance, they will give an average. Definitely an average. If your kid's going to Boston or New York, you got to factor in things like flights, the increased cost of food, gas. all that stuff has to be factored in there. This is the cost of attendance for an average student. And typically, it's an average in-state student. Okay? At junior college, most junior colleges do not have dorms. So you're going to factor in off-campus housing, which typically, you're not going to necessarily have the easiest way to pay for that. Sometimes you can get a check that will help with support that piece, but sometimes that's self-pay. Okay, if you're staying in some apartment, they're not going to be hooked up with the FAFSA necessarily and be able to take those checks. Consider transfer rates if you want to go to a four-year college. It's a great way. Say you didn't really, high school didn't click for you. High school was not the spot. And it wasn't the place where I really felt like I was connected, that I had to take a bunch of classes that were not interesting to me, and maybe I didn't do so well. I pulled some C's, I got an F or a D or something like that, but I still want to go and get my bachelor's degree or higher. Okay? I know that I want to go to school. I know that I want to pursue something that requires a degree like that. Starting at the community college, it is nice because it kind of gives you a clean slate. All right. Once you enter community college as essentially a transfer student or a first-time freshman, after you complete what's about 60 transferable units or about 2 years worth of full-time study, you're then eligible to transfer and apply for transfer into four-year schools, into private schools. Private schools, you can even transfer in earlier if you wanted to. They don't set those rules aside. But you can transfer in, and they don't really care about your high school grades. They're not going to make you take the SAT. They don't care about your transfer grade or your high school GPA. They're looking at your college performance at that point. So that's a really nice thing, that if we are that student that maybe didn't do so hot, then we have a fresh start. And we can get anywhere we want. UCLA, Berkeley, all these schools you can get into based on your transfer, your community college coursework. Which sometimes it takes that long. You know, you might have had a bad 9th and 10th grade year and you picked it up in the 11th and 12th. Okay, sometimes that can preclude you from certain schools, but by doing this, it might open up those options again. All right, please keep checking deadlines. Every community college, as well as every four-year college, has different deadlines throughout the year. Typically, later. So usually you start kind of with the enrollment process, not even the application, but enrollment process. Sometime anywhere between usually November and almost April or May, okay? And most incoming freshmen are actually gonna register for classes usually before they even graduate. So they'll pick their classes now for when they go in the fall at the community college level, okay? Some general pieces of information about applications just to keep in mind and remember. Double check, triple check, quadruple check all of your work, okay? I have seen your PSAT scores, Mr. Nathan with an 8 or something like that, okay? So there's a lot of areas where you can mess up the application. And it's not because you're not smart, it's not because, you know, you're not following directions even, but you click the wrong box, you type the wrong letter, okay? So always double check that, please, please, please. Because if there's one thing that stands out, it's not that D, it's spelling your own name wrong. So please double check that. Let someone else, preferably a parent, but maybe not just your parent, because your parent probably zoned in with that too. You guys get application blindness. Okay, you guys are looking at it for so long, just like reading essays. You guys are so in tune with what you're reading, you don't catch the mistakes. Have an English teacher read your essay. Have me look at your application. Have a parent check it over. All those things are super important for you guys, just to have someone else be sure to look at that. Actually submit your applications. Be surprised, this is actually an issue. Sometimes the applications aren't so clear. So sometimes did I actually submit that or not? Okay, unless you get a confirmation email and a confirmation page that has some sort of number on it, the likelihood is you might not have submitted that application. Print everything with a confirmation number on it. And two, check your bank statements. Okay, if you have to pay for some sort of application, double check your bank statements, because then you can pull it up and say, hey, you took my money. Why didn't you take my application if something comes up later? If you have both those things, you're golden, typically. Can't guarantee 100%. But update your Naviance account regularly. Requesting a transcript. this process, requesting transcripts, is not an automatic process. We are not connected to any type of application system that you might submit. So when you hit submit, I don't get an automatic notification on my phone saying, hey, you know, Garrett submitted his application. Great. Send his transcript. No, you have to go online and request that, communicate with me directly to do that. And keep focusing on your academic work throughout the process. All right. We're getting close to being done. One thing that I'm going to focus on here is the common application. Can't see it up there. Common application. All right. This is a standardized application for about 600-ish, more or less, different schools around the country and internationally. So common application, it's the common application with a big C and a big A, okay, a proper name. Other schools have common application, low C, low A, but those are going to be like your UC and CSU applications. Okay, it's not the common app. It is a common application for a system of schools. Okay, so don't confuse the two. Many times, schools that are on this common application will give you a different opportunity to apply as well. Say, for example, you're not applying to any of their schools in the common app. You might just want to fill out their separate school-specific app. That's available too. Universal application, we don't see that very often. Don't have many students applying to the Common Black application. Priority applications basically allow you to submit early, typically. They usually don't give you a huge bump in terms of your admissibility. All right, so just read through all the fine print. Fast apps are something that they might have already pre-filled out for you based on information they got off the PSAT or other things. And then the UC and CSU mentor common application with low C, low A. All right, a new application. How many of you guys have heard of this? Oh, good, because nobody else has either. So this is a new application. You probably will start hearing more about it if you haven't yet. It's called the Coalition for Access something or other. I forgot the. It's a big, long word. It's called the Coalition app. You'll see there's about 50 different schools on this application, and they're pretty big name schools. Okay. However, they decided to plop this on us in about September, and we'll have people applying this fall. Okay. That is not typically how any program works. Just think about Windows. This is a Windows equivalent. This is a very complicated process. If Windows was released in 6 months, from start to finish, it would probably be a crap show. Okay? And that's what this is probably going to be like. Okay? There are three schools that are exclusive to this application. So if you are applying to any of those three schools, University of Washington in Seattle, University of Florida, and University of Maryland. We don't have tons of applications for those schools. But if you are applying to those, just know that you do have to use this application. Otherwise, my office this year, and just like many other private and public schools across the country, will not be actively supporting this application because we do not want you guys to be their guinea pigs. Okay? Every school that's in this program has both typically the Common App and their own application also available. I would highly suggest avoiding this application. I would highly suggest using the Common Application instead. Okay, that's your word of warning regarding the Coalition. Next, the following year, we'll see. It's really hard to say because they literally have not told us hardly anything about what this is going to look like. Okay, so for that reason, I would highly suggest avoiding the Coalition application. All right, I think we're almost finished here. So, different admissions types. All right, and this is kind of where it gets a little bit confusing. Again, this will be published online, and I apologize, it's kind of small. I'll read it to you. We have two main different types of four-year applications. This usually you don't see much of this at the trade school or junior college level. You might, especially if you're like applying to maybe an impacted program or a very specific trade school. But this is typically a four-year college process, this type of wording. Two main top-tier levels. We have non-restrictive and restrictive. And they literally mean kind of what they mean. Okay? Non-restrictive means, we don't care what you do about everything else, really. Restrictive says, you can only do what we say you can do. Okay, that's the two top-tier levels. Underneath each of them, so the biggest one that you really need to pay attention to is the restrictive application plans. Those are the ones on the right. And we have two main ones. The big one that you're going to see is ED. It's not what you think. Sorry, that was bad. early decision. Emotionally disturbed, that's what I meant. Early decision, okay? That is the number one thing. It's the biggest way to show what's called demonstrated interest. I'll talk a little bit more about that in the next slide. But early decision has a early deadline, early. But you are literally making a binding, legally binding decision that you are going to go there in the fall. Or they will charge you tuition and maybe take you to court. Okay? So it's a very important thing. It's very great if you are 100%, maybe even 110% sure that this college is the right school for you and your child. Or your well, really, the child is 100% sure, and you're 100% sure you're going to be able to pay for it, too. Typically, the financial aid is a very important thing to consider for that, because you are not going to know your financial status and what your financial aid package is going to look like when you hit the submit button that says, I'm agreeing to all this lawyer talk down here, which is very important that I suggest reading. That is binding, so you cannot, it takes an act of God to get out of that contract. It does happen, you know, our house burnt down, I lost my job, my dog ran away, all that kind of stuff. You can call the financial aid officers, and they have what's called professional judgment, meaning they can make certain decisions based on the school, but saying, I changed my mind, is not a good enough excuse. Okay, so just make sure that you understand that one. Restrictive early action is fairly similar. They're going to say that you can't apply anywhere except for our institution under early decision or restrictive early action or any other restrictive plan. But the difference is it's going to be not binding, meaning you can apply one place early, and it's that place, but you don't have to go there. So that's restrictive early action, the difference between those two. Okay. The left-hand side, the non-restrictive, you have your regular decision, which is your standard application process. That's going to be, hey, you know, our deadline is November 30th, submit your application, and we're all good to go. And you're in the pool with everybody else. Rolling admissions is probably you see that typically at schools that are relatively less selective. UNR, for example, is a rolling admissions school. Montana State is a rolling admissions school. Again, not because they're not quality institutions, but because they typically just don't attract as many students. Not tons of students want to go move to Reno. A lot of students want to go to San Diego and San Francisco, and Chicago, you know, other big metropolis areas. Reno's not up there on that list, so they don't have the same kind of like locational clout that requires them to be highly selective. But they're a Division I research or Division II research institution. They're really, really strong schools. Same thing with Montana State. Early action as well. Early action, basically, again, non-binding. What that does is it typically has a earlier deadline. Some of these, when you see early, that's what it means. Usually has an earlier deadline from the regular decision deadline. So say an early action deadline might be December 31st. The early action or early restrictive early action deadline might be, say, November 1st. Okay. The big thing about that is not necessarily it's going to give you a huge boost in terms of admissions. Okay. Maybe a slight, a little bit, but not like early decision. The early decision is big, early action is a little bit. The biggest benefit of doing early action is typically with that earlier application, you get back the decision earlier. So where this early regular decision might not get it till March, you might get it in February. Okay, so it gives you a little bit more time to think about it. You can also ponder your financial status a little bit longer. I wouldn't apply everywhere early. Pick one or two if you're going to do early action and non-restrictive, and maybe pick a couple, maybe your top ones, and maybe do early. I wouldn't plan on doing everything early. It just makes a really hectic fall. Okay? Any questions about this? There's a lot more reading that you can do online about some of this, and I do suggest reading every application you go through if you are going to do any of these restrictive or early action. They're going to have a page or some language that you're going to agree to. Read it all. Maybe copy and paste it into another document so you can save it. But just understand what you're going to be reading. Yeah.
The regular decision, isn't that generally January 1st? Is that?
It's different. Every school that you're going to encounter typically is going to have a different set of deadlines.
Of regular decision.
Yep.
Okay.
So, you know, private schools will typically, you'll see them a little bit later in the year. So January is not uncommon. January 15th, January 30th, February 1st. Not uncommon deadlines that you'll see. Your state schools, November 30th. So CSUs and UCs are all November 30th. we are starting to see a little bit more of what we would call early applications for like Cal Poly and stuff like that. We haven't seen any huge benefit in doing early or not. So it's up to you. There's not any, we can't link any direct correlation to being admitted or not being admitted based on whether you applied early or not for similarly qualified students. Again, it's earlier notification of your decision. Good questions. Anything else before we move on? I know I'm putting myself to sleep too, so we'll keep going. So my job is, I don't like tour guide is not the right word, but I am your gondola driver. I am the person that's kind of helping you find your way through all the twists and turns of the back alleys of college admissions. Okay? And the nice thing is, parents, so are you. You're kind of the person in the front of the boat. I'm in the back of the boat. You guys are the ones actually like rowing and doing all the work, students. Okay, so that's kind of a nice thing, but again, it's scary. And please let them do the work. I can't tell you how many parents will step in and make, you know, their student is maybe slacking, putting it off. And while I hate to see a student not do something or not get in somewhere because they missed a deadline, at this point, my developmental brain and my counseling brain says if they are going to miss this deadline, they're probably not ready for that four-year college experience at that point. Okay? That might change 6 months from now, but at some point we have to put our foot down a little bit and say, you know what, this is your process. I'm here to remind you, I'm here to nag you a little bit, but once you cross that line from reminding and nagging to actually doing, that is a line you can't undo, and that's a line that's very telling about where your student maybe is or is not. Okay, so think about that line. Make sure that line is clear, though, with your son or daughter. Okay. The other line to make very clear is how much you can or cannot afford. Do not play the, oh, we'll see when we get there. Be very upfront, parents, with your kids about, this is the amount of money we have set aside, or we have no money set aside. If you're going to go to this school, you are understanding that we're going to help you pay for like the application fees maybe. We might be able to do what the FAFSA says we're going to be able to do, and we might have a book allowance for you. But apart from that, you're going to have to fund your own schooling. Meaning if you're going to go to a school that costs you $60,000 a year, unless you work your butt off and get a bunch of merit aid, you're going to come out of school very in debt. Okay, and that's something the students need to know so they make a wise decision. And students really consider that. A school that's really top class, for lack of a better word, if you're going to be paying $60,000 a year and taking loans out for that, probably not a good call, especially for undergraduate school. You don't want to leave with $200,000 of undergraduate debt. Okay? Graduate school, postgraduate school, maybe. That's worth it. Everybody's getting BAs these days. Okay? You're not going to make $200,000 a year with a bachelor's degree to repay that right away. Okay, so just keep that in mind. So I think we know kind of what I have to do. Now, Advanced Family Connection, if you guys, students, you haven't been using that, it's a very useful tool. It will become more and more of a central part of your senior year. I can see how often you are logging into that. If I see 3 times in January, there's going to be something wrong with that. Okay? This is a tool that not only helps you, but it helps me help you, helps your parents help you. Okay? If you are logging in and keeping it up to date, I can help you before we come in and have a meeting. You set up an appointment and say, confused. That's the subject line you put in. I don't know what we're meeting about. Okay? But I can log in, and if your application list is up to date, I can say, hey, they're applying to Berkeley, they're applying to MIT, they're applying to all these places, but they got a 3.2. We need to have a discussion about this. Okay? We need to talk about this. Well, I'm all for it. Reach schools. Don't hear me wrong. If you want to go to Berkeley and you got a 3.0, people get into Berkeley with a 3.0. You got to be awesome in other ways. Literally awesome in other ways. But, which all of you guys are. But, you literally have to, don't read into that too much, students. You're awesome. Sometimes you can say, oh, Mr. Eames said I could do that. Okay, cool. Again, we're not going to have 7 schools of those reach schools. So if I see those 7 schools being reach schools, I'm going to say, hey, let's rethink this a little bit. Which of these two, which maybe 2 or 3 of these might you want to keep? And and maybe which other ones might be appropriate, or I can suggest other appropriate ones that fit the stylistic and kind of environmental kind of similarities of that school that you're reaching for in schools that are maybe less selective. Okay. Again, you can request transcripts through Navets. You can directly access the contact information for their admissions people at the schools. Take you directly to the website. It'll also typically take you directly to the application itself, so when that's open. Family connection is not a substitute for an open conversation with me or a parent saying, well, I Googled it. That does not solve certain problems. Okay? So please ask me. Sometimes I do get busy. I recognize that. Sometimes I have back-to-back schedules. Sometimes I'm off campus. But be persistent. Okay? And don't assume that I know every question that you guys have. My MS degree on my wall does not mean mind-reading science. Okay? That's not my best forte. If you do not use it, it remains static. Meaning, it does not help you. The more you use it, the more helpful it gets. And the more helpful it gets to all of us. Okay? It collects data from all of us. You can log in and see the percentage of admissions from our individual North Tahoe High School students on individual schools. You can log in and see there were 27 students that applied to Cal Poly and 13 of them got in. You can look at their average GPA from our graduates. Okay, so you can see the national statistics. You can also see our statistics. Again, financial aid, we'll skip. We talked about that. Deadlines, make sure that you observe deadlines on everything. You're going to hear me say it time and time again, deadlines, they all, I can't even say it that much. They are super important. I have learned, and I set my deadlines usually about a day or two early, because I know at midnight, Mr. Ream, I forgot to turn in my PSAT paperwork. Okay, great, turned it in. I thought about that ahead of time. Colleges of financial aid, they don't. It says 11:59 p.m. and it's 12:01, you just missed out. And they are not forgiving. Okay, so they will not go back and change that. They will just say, sorry, apply in the winter, see you as a transfer student, tough. Okay, so please observe deadlines completely.
You can apply earlier, though.
Yes, you don't have to like hit the minute.
Everybody wait.
No, and I would highly suggest not waiting. Okay. I have seen circumstances where students applied and they were literally ready to hit submit even 6 or 7 hours before, like, say, the CSU UC deadline on November 30th, and the servers got overloaded, and they crashed, and the student didn't end up applying. Colleges are not forgiving about that. You know what they're going to tell you? It's been open for an entire month. Why did you wait till the last 6 hours? So, you know, if you are done, submit that thing. As long as you are 100% sure that it's polished. Good question, yeah.
Sorry, a couple more questions. If we wanted to go on Naviance as a parent, should we go on to our
So you can. I can. If you email me, I can also give you access for a parent so that you can, you basically get the same access, but when you add or take things off and that kind of stuff or make suggestions, it shows up as parents. You can't add certain things or do certain things that really, you know, I don't want you to say, oh, I'm going to Berkeley when they're going to, you know, Chico or something like that, and I send a transcript to the wrong place. So the student really should have the reins, and you should be able to say, hey, this is what we think. And the student can say, nope, I don't think that. But I can give you, if you just email me and say, can you please give me my login code for Naviance, I can send that out.
And that'll be sort of linked to your students.
Yes, it is. It is linked to your student.
Okay.
So you'll log in and see essentially what they see. And use the same tools, so you can use the research tools too.
Okay. And the other question is, do you know when the Common App opens?
You can actually start filling it out now. There's something that because it will now roll over, but you might want to just look it up or shoot me an email to remind me. There's some specific setting when you create the account that you have to set up so that it doesn't think you're applying this year that you're applying next year. I forget what that drop down or the...
You mean the Common App?
Yes,
or the
big C.
Yeah, the Common App.
When I say Common App,
you mean the capitalized.
Yes. If I say Common Application, Common App is the like literally the term that they use for that. So if you say Common Application, that's typically little C's. But it's always good to verify because it's kind of confusing. But yes, you can apply for that now to start using it. I wouldn't start adding schools and like uploading your essays and stuff like that until kind of August rolls around. I want to say it's August 15th-ish is when things kind of roll over. But don't quote me on that. It'll say on their website. CommonApp.org is the website. Again, a lot of students will come back in the fall, and we're pretty much done. But a lot of students will come back in the fall and be raring to go. They'll hit the ground running. Some students will not be raring to go, but a lot of them will. Be like, yeah, I'm into this. Let's do this. I'll get on Naviance. I'll do my list. I'll get my applications going. I'll start my essays. And about 2 weeks later, AP Calc hits. And about 2 weeks after that, anatomy hits. And other things hit. And soccer hits. And all this other stuff that's more fun hits. And they give up. And they wait until the very end. Okay, so my advice to you seniors and your parents for encouraging your senior students is work on being the tortoise. Okay? It's not about how fast you go. It's about finishing and finishing on time. Okay. So if it's better for you to not do everything right off the bat and balance your time out and spread it out over 3 months before the deadline rather than trying to finish it all at once, do that as long as it's the best way for you. Okay. Because I don't want you to burn out. It's a great way to avoid senioritis. Talked about deadlines. Let's see. NCAA, I'll mention that. If you guys are looking at NCAA Division 1 or 2, you need to, before school's out, I would suggest in the next month, get onto the NCAA Clearinghouse and request a transcript from me. I'll upload it. You also need to send test scores in your senior year, as well as final transcripts, which if you have an account, I send final transcripts for everybody that's on the NCAA. If you're doing NCAA Division 3, you don't need to get cleared or anything like that, but it's just something to keep in mind. Highly selective schools, again, almost everyone's going to have great grades. Everybody's going to be a stellar student who's taken a bunch of AP classes or college-level coursework to have a great GPA. Okay, that's typically the students who you see apply and get into those schools. However, the number one thing that they say really sets students apart is not what they do in school. Okay, this is coming from the horse's mouth of admissions officers who read these things and go to committee for these things. The thing that sets people apart is what they're doing outside of school. Sports are okay. It's a good activity. But really it's going to be what you're involved in. What are you passionate about? What things have you taken on, shown leadership in, and completed? What things are you so involved in that that's like your lifeblood? Okay? It's not doing your 8 hours of community service because we tell you to. It's I'm doing 80 hours of community service because I love it. Or it's good for me. Or it's good for my community. Okay? Not saying you have to go out and like spend every weekend doing community service, but if you're looking at how to set yourself apart, it's a wonderful way to do that. It's a little challenging up here, we know. Not always tons of opportunities, but the people that get into those places are the people that make the opportunities for themselves. They reach out to the architect and say, hey, I just want to volunteer because I'm interested in it. They say, hey, can you use some help in the vet's office? I'd really like to learn more about it. And they make those opportunities. They're not posted on our bulletin boards here at school. Finally, research. Test prep, you have free test prep through Khan Academy. Most students are going to have already started the SATs or the ACTs this year, I hope. If you haven't, you need to probably sign up to take one or two of them at least in the fall. But summer is another great time to work on that prep. Another great summer activity. We are going to be changing. Naviance has a free prep tool. Right now it's on the SAT. Please note that in about 3 weeks it's going to be switching to the ACT. Okay. The reason why we are doing this is because Khan Academy now has come out directly partnered with the College Board, who is the maker of the SAT, to provide free SAT prep, which is equal or better than what we had here for the SAT. And we did not have anything for the ACT. So because you can access this thing for free, that's literally connected to the test. They are the first people to get any type of retired test questions, any practice test that's retired, and it actually links to your PSAT scores. It's wonderful. We didn't want to double dip. So we're going to be changing this one through Naviance to the ACT prep, and it's still a very good tool. So I would suggest if you're looking for an ACT prep tool, check that out. It'll probably become accessible starting in July. When it will switch. Okay, and I apologize if you were working on the SAT prep program through Naviance. I'm I'm really sorry about that, but it's going to be going away for the SAT. We can't afford both. It's not going to be called PrepMe. It's going to be called Naviance Test Prep, but it's in that very similar location when you log into Naviance. That's a screenshot of Naviance. Adding schools, we'll go over this with your seniors later. And I'll do this later. This is not something we need to do at this point. Okay. 5 minutes under. Yeah. All right. So, any questions? Yeah.
How many letters of recommendation is
there? It really depends. So, in general, about one, but often two or three. So, letters of recommendation, I've seen as many as five, and many times it's through the common application, and as many as none. So, every school is going to set their required number. If they have a certain required and recommended number, you might see two required, four recommended. Okay, they're going to say you have to submit two, but we highly suggest four. That's kind of what that means. And so you'll see that when you look underneath recommendations for each school and add them to that common application list. Yeah?
Are letter recommendations specific to schools, or can they be one for more specific for the students?
Yeah. So they can be. My general answer is going to be that almost every teacher and myself write general letters of recommendation for students. You know, if I'm going to write 70 letters of recommendation that take me 2 hours each, and a teacher's going to do that, if you're going to apply to 7 to 10 schools, and I've got to personalize that for 7 to 10 different schools for each individual student, that becomes quickly 200 to 300 letters, which becomes my entire fall. So I don't get anything else done. So generally we apply, and colleges, they know that. And they'll say to your admissions committee, if you're applying for some like super, super awesome like pre-astronaut program or something like that, and you need a very specific letter of recommendation speaking to your astronauting ability, we can write those, but we need to know about that ahead of time. Okay, we're like an honors program that requires certain things. Just give us a heads up. All letters of recommendation, please do, again, no slamming papers on the ground or on our desk saying, please write, or just write this. Always say the P word, please. And no, it's not part of our job. It's part of our job, but we are not required to write letters. Okay? There are circumstances where I, one, maybe don't feel comfortable writing a letter, or two, I might say, you know, I haven't seen you enough, or I haven't seen your best side enough to be able to write you a strong letter. If I cannot write you a letter that I'm confident will help you, most likely I'm going to say, I'm really sorry, I can't write you a letter that I feel will be beneficial to you. If there's someone else that you might want to substitute in my place? Because most people are going to need a letter from me. There's a counselor that goes along with your reports. But your teachers might say the same thing. They might say, you want me to write you a letter after you just sat around in the back of my class and watched YouTube all day? Nope. Okay, so you might want to think about who you ask and that they've had a good experience with you and that they know also kind of what your attributes are as a student and as a person. Because they're going to speak to your qualities as a student inside the classroom. Are you respectful? Do you listen? But also your qualities as a person. So that's why it's really important not just to get to know your teachers as teachers, but like talk to them about like, hey, I didn't know you had a dog. I got a dog. You know, have like good actual conversations with people. You know, and it's good practice, but it also helps give them fodder for your letters. That helps give personality. Most schools don't require interviews anymore to get in. Those interviews have become letters. That is the most personalizing piece of those applications. And so both for financial aid purposes, you know, we review letters and applications for financial aid. We're awarding that $80,000. And they read every letter anonymously, but they read every letter. And it's amazing their reactions of, oh, that's cool. Or, man, that poor kid, or something like that. And so that really gives context to your transcript, to what classes you're taking, okay? You know, if your letter talks about how I had a pet cow when I was growing up, I don't know why I'm using animals so much. If I had a pet cow growing up, my pet cow died of mad cow disease when I was 10, and that inspired me to become a vet. You know, that story is powerful, and that gives relevance to why you took ag science, why you took, you know, anatomy and physiology. It gives relevance to the courses that you've taken. So that's the big important factor of those letters, is it personalizes and gives a face to it, where otherwise you're just looking at a series of classes, which is pretty impersonal. Same thing with the essays. Those are your interviews. So make yourself stand out as a person, not just someone writing, trying to get into a school. You know, they tell us, please don't do anything grammatically wrong. They tell us they don't really care about that, but they do. I believe they lie to us. Because if you can't spell things right, if there's major grammatical errors, unless it's like your whole thing of like, and now I'm going to tell you that I'm dyslexic, and that kind of ties all of everything that you've just done in the essay together at the very end, then that's something that might make sense. But if you are not using it for like a purpose like that, and I would be wary about that too. Just I would just write like a college person, a high school educated person, and do your best to not make mistakes. But just know, if you guys miss a comma at the right spot, they're not going to like kick you to the curb because you guys didn't, you know, put grammar in the right spot. But do focus on that. Good questions. Any other questions? Feel free, if you guys don't have questions or if you don't want to hang out for questions, if you don't hurt my feelings, I'll leave. But if there are questions, I'm happy to stick around for a few minutes. Otherwise, this will be posted on YouTube as well as online if like your student didn't make it and you want them to watch it, or you want to go back to any part of the video for clarification. But thank you guys for coming, and we'll see you guys in the fall. I saw you.